Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Welcome to today's webinar, Speed Wars, Database Performance in the Cloud. I'm Janet Lafleur, Director of Product Marketing here at Lightbits, and I'm happy to be here today with Sagy Volkov, our Distinguished Performance Architect. As our performance expert, he'll go through the benchmarking that he did for several popular databases. He'll compare how they perform with native cloud storage versus the Lightbits cloud data platform. So we'll start with a quick introduction to the barriers our customers are facing to their cloud success and how Lightbits helps break down those barriers by providing this high performance storage platform with SAN-like capabilities. Then I'll turn it over to Sagy, who will give you a deep dive on the databases with all the benchmarking setup, results, et cetera, plus some cost comparisons. Then we'll step through the TCO or total cost of ownership analysis we did for an e-commerce customer. Then finally, we'll share our cloud quick start program for doing proof of value projects. I'll just give you a hint. We're so confident that we can demonstrate success that it comes with a money back guarantee. So, a little background. As organizations build more and more cloud native applications and migrate more and more legacy ones to the cloud, we find they often run into barriers. Sometimes it's performance, sometimes cost, sometimes resiliency, and sometimes it's all three. This is especially true for performance sensitive workloads like databases and other mission critical applications, or in many cases, once you get to a large scale virtualized or container environment. The high costs are often driven by having to purchase expensive storage tiers to prevent those storage bottlenecks, especially as your application scales to accommodate your business growth. And at the same time, the native cloud storage doesn't always provide the data services that our customers are looking for. That's the replication, the snapshots, clones, et cetera. That's where Lightbits for the public cloud comes in. Lightbits eliminates the over-provisioning of expensive cloud storage while ensuring performance for storage-intensive workloads. With Lightbits, you can scale your storage independently from performance, and you'll get stronger data protection and higher availability, plus those enterprise data services that I was talking about. With Lightbits, you can break this direct attached model that cloud storage has and get the benefits of a SAN in a cloud. With Lightbits, your storage resources are unified so they can be managed directly and collectively. And that way you can increase your utilization. You won't have to pay any additional charges for provisioned IOPS. You'll get thin provisioning and compression to conserve your capacity. Because remember, you're paying for those high tiers. You want to conserve that capacity. You'll get high availability through synchronous replication, both within and across availability zones, and you'll get unlimited fast snapshots and clones, all at no additional cost. So, I have bad news. We had set up some poll questions, but for some reason our polling interface is not working right now. So just kind of think about this. We'd love to hear from you if you want to put a comment in or ask a question around this. But we're finding there's basically the people we've polled before are like split pretty evenly between these three situations, either, only operating in the public cloud selectively, or considering both equally and choosing based on specific workloads. And then others are choosing it, another third are choosing it by default and only use on-premises when they need to. So at this point, I'm going to give you over to Sagy, who's going to talk about performance and give you all the details, how Lightbits performs in the cloud. Take it away, Sagy. Hi.
Hey, folks. So what I'm going to start with is a general performance of Lightbits in the cloud before we dive into in databases. But even before that, I really want to emphasize on a few of the things that Janet have said. Remember, Lightbits, everything is thin provision. You can choose the number of replicas that you want to have in the cluster. And you do not pay for snapshots and cloning. These are before even heading into the performance level. These are very big advantages comparing to a native cloud storage solution or even let's say not native cloud storage solution that are competing with the Lightbits. The graph you see now in front of you is from AWS. This was done with three targets of Lightbits, I4i Metal on AWS. We support the i3n and i4i family of instances. I4i Metal has 8 NVMe devices in each of the Lightbits nodes. And what you see here, the bars represents the latency, which is mostly sub-millisecond, and the lines are the IOPS for read and write. And you can see the consistency, you know, more IOPS are being read or written, and you can see the, you know, the differences in the latency. The numbers on the left, 4K read, 1.9 million from a single client. Of course, provide that your client has enough network bandwidth to perform such operations, which in AWS and even in Azure and GCP now is fairly easy. Just a note, most of these numbers were actually with previous versions of Lightbits. Since then, we actually moved everything from on the target side from being from the Linux side, from the kernel side into user space, and we actually see even more improvement in performance. So this is general performance on AWS. And on a similar graph with Azure. This was done with the three clients. The previous one was just done with a single client. So this is three clients aggregated. Again, in Azure, we're using L64 SV3 instances in this case, and 8 NVMe devices as well in each of them. And you can see the performance that a single client can a single volume can provide from the Lightbits cluster. Now let's dive into some real database performance numbers. So these are Oracle performance numbers in AWS. The orange bars are IO2 Block Express. This is the highest or the high-end EBS storage, which has a limitation of either 256 IOPS per volume and 350,000 IOPS per your instance. This is running versus three Lightbits targets, I4i Metal. And the Oracle is running on R6IN 24X, if I remember correctly. And there's a single Oracle database on each of the client side on the R6 I24. And on the Lightbit side, we use the 16 volumes on the IO2 Block Express side. I've used several permutations between 4 volumes or 16 volumes, all sorts of triads. So you're actually getting, you're seeing the best numbers that the IO2 Block Express could provide, regardless of how many volumes I was trying to make it. As I said, the limitation of IO2 Block Express is shown here. There's a limit per volume, and there's a limit per what a client can consume or EC2 instance can consume. I could not get into the 350,000 IOPS in any of my tests. Just a note, of course, all of these tests were done with the SLOB, which is the de facto storage testing mechanism for storage for Oracle. And as you can see, there's a large difference in performance between the between running with Lightbits and running with IO2 Block Express. The X bar basically shows that I've done the test with either 0% updates, which is 100% read, or I've pushed 25% updates, 50% updates, and 100% updates of data. And of course, Lightbits was outperforming IO2 Block Express in any of these tests. This is also three replicas of Lightbits. That's showed a big difference between Lightbits and IO2 Block Express with Oracle, which is a very performant database that can really stress the storage subsystem. Let's move to the same test that I've done in Azure. So Azure UltraDisk has a lower limitation than what IO2 Block Express can provide. It is limited into a ADK ADK per instance, and although Azure also announced that it's 160K, it's 160K when the volume is shared between two instances. So this is a one-to-one relationship. So as you can see, the limit of what we can achieve, and you can see again on Azure instances using Lightbit software, the big difference, a bigger difference even when running Oracle. These are the same tests. You can see that if you compare the numbers to AWS, the general Oracle numbers for Lightbits were a little bit lower than what we can perform in AWS. And that makes sense since AWS is a little bit ahead in instances that provide storage. But there's a massive difference between what Azure built-in storage can provide and what you can achieve with Lightbits. Again, these are the same slope tests. I think there's a we have a white paper for this and a white paper for the previous slide, and which also holds a Git repo for creating all the databases automatically and in parallel and running all the tests with slob in parallel. So you can feel free to look into that.
Our poll question today, but wanted to say two things. First of all, the white papers that Sagy mentioned are going to be available through Bright Talk. There's a upload area for documents. And then secondly, since I can't ask you this question, I will give you the answers from the previous time we asked this, which is have you migrated database workloads to find out where people were in this kind of process? And 16% of the people polled last time said they'd migrated almost all of them. 29% said that they'd migrated a few that really weren't mission critical. And that 10% said they were in the process of migrating their first ones. 32% they said they hadn't started yet, which is probably why they're coming to learn more about this process. And then 13% in the last time we polled said that they didn't support any database workloads. So I'm going to go back to Sagy. He's got more databases to tackle. It's not just about Oracle. We got more coming.
All right. So these are MySQL tests that I've done using Sysbench. What I was doing here, basically, I was running because I wanted to take out any kind of network latency that might impact the test. I've ran these on a R6IN 16X, if I'm not mistaken, and I ran a MySQL database, and I ran Sysbench on the same machine. So Sysbench, basically emulating an application targeting the MySQL, was a running locally on the same client where the MySQL was. On the Lightbits and IO2 Block Express side, I was using three volumes for Lightbits and 3 volumes for IO2 Block Express with a RAID 0 on top of them, and the ADM RAID 0 in Linux. And you can see the performance you know, differences between running using Lightbits and using IO2 Block Express. Now, I don't have a slide for Postgres because I'm just in the middle of working on this, but I can already tell you, you know, Postgres is a more performant database than MySQL. And I've done tests actually with on Kubernetes with Postgres, and the gap is much higher. It's about 3 times all over. Whether you choose select an insert or select an updates, which of course is a good reminder for me to remind that the X bar here is basically how Sysbench is running. So. You can kind of tune Sysbench into how many out of 10 transactions you want to be an insert or an update or a non-insert update write impact, like index change and things like that. So this is for, you know, the MySQL stuff. In the future, we'll probably have another webinar, and I'll publish a blog about the Postgres performance. This is a kind of a price comparison, which includes all, some of the summary from that of that what I talked previously. It shows you it shows you the cost translation into the client side and the storage side. And so what I've done is basically how much you are paying to run your database. And Lightbits is faster, but you can see that cost-wise, it's we are a lot cheaper. Actually, one point in here and in the price comparison, this price, I guess the second point on the right side, the 3 times I4I X large, the Lightbits cluster, this price is actually using on-demand pricing. So if you're actually heading into AWS and choose to pay on-demand yearly a yearly with no upfront or a yearly with a 1 year upfront, this cost is getting even lower. On the IO2, on the IO2 Block Express side, cost stays the same. There's no impact to things. This is also a very good point again to remind about the provision IOPS. In IO2 and IO2 Block Express, you have to announce basically and decide each the volume that you create, how many IOPS will it be able to consume. So. You might start with something extremely high, let's say at the top end, 256,000 IOPS. There's not an easy way to reduce it. You start to use it and you see your database is not that performant, or your application or whatever. There's no easy way to reduce this limitation. You basically have to create another volume, copy the data, or some sort of a snapshot. It's not very transparent. On Lightbits, the performance that you are going to achieve per volume or per client is only decided by one, is the total performance that the Lightbits cluster can provide. All these tests were done with the minimal Lightbits cluster of 3 instances. You can always start to add more instances all the way to 16 and later on to 64. And as you add more instances into the Lightbits cluster, you're basically not only growing your capacity, you're also growing your general cluster performance ability. So it's the cluster ability to provide the IOPS and bandwidth. And of course, the client side needs to be able to consume this. It's very important to remember. On the Lightbits side, if you do want to limit, you have QoS. But again, everything is dynamic. If you feel like your database need a little bit more bandwidth, just play with your QoS and allow more, or just have no QoS at all on the volumes. Let's move to MongoDB. Mongo is probably the least performant database from this, you know, family of databases that we have discussed. Of course, it's aimed, it's a NoSQL database. It doesn't aim to read from tables. But even these tests with Mongo were actually done on a Kubernetes or OpenShift, to be exact, where I was running several of these Mongo pods on a worker node. And I was basically consuming the or averaging the and the test was of course with the YCSB, the IO Cloud Service benchmark, which basically emulate like an online store. You know, it's pretty old, but used a lot today as a benchmark. And what I did is I took an average of all the pods from all the worker nodes and did an average of the operations per second that the YCSB was able to do. And you can see that in all these tests, Lightbits was faster. Same comparison with cost as well. And this was done, as you can see, with the three worker nodes. So worker nodes, same thing on the IO2 Block Express or the Lightbits side. But then the price comparison is between the how you provide the storage. And again, peer database, you can see the price difference. So this is basically, so as you can see here, 6 MongoDB pods running in a cluster. So just think, you know, as an organization, you're running several MongoDB databases. They can all consume storage from a single Lightbits cluster. And that's also a very good point. You can use several applications. I'm just trying to show performance and cost perspective or saving with the databases. But Lightbits is an NVMe block provider over a TCP. So any application that you might want to use can use the Lightbits. We have, as you can see here, drivers for CSI drivers for Kubernetes. We have seen the drivers for OpenStack. We are in also in a VMware, part of the VMware kernel since version 7.03. And we are part of the Linux kernel since version 4.10, which means any enterprise Linux that you have been using in the last 3-4 years already have NVMe over TCP inside the kernel. And I think I'm going to allow Janet to continue from here.
Okay. Yes, thanks, Sagy. Before we get into this, I wanted to remind you that we do have a Q&A session at the end. So we have 2 questions so far to address, but we'd love to have more for at the end of this presentation, we'll answer them. So Sagy talked a lot about, you know, cost, but to show how this translates into a specific environment, say like yours, let me show you an example of how we do a TCO analysis with our potential customers. In this case, this was a large e-commerce customer that we worked with, and they are the number one online vendor in their product segment in a very huge market. I can't name them at this point, but they came to us because they were running a large number of Azure VMs, 800 of them, and they had 2 petabytes of data supporting that database. They had it all on Azure Premium SSDs, and they were using it with an extensive AKS cluster, that's Kubernetes, running databases and for their logging. At this scale, it's not surprising that their Azure environment costs were really extremely high. They wanted to cut those costs wherever they could. And they figured that if they optimized their applications and the storage, they could put that saved money back into the business to sustain their growth targets, because they're looking at double-digit growth every year. And the last thing you want to do is have things fail as your business takes off. So after a number of discussions, fact-finding interviews to get their data, we took that data that they shared and built this TCO analysis and an action plan to go with it. We found that the company was over provisioning both their Azure disk and compute resources to reach that performance that they needed, and that Lightbits could eliminate the over provisioning that was wasting all these resources. By replacing Azure managed disk with Lightbits, we determined that we could save them 36% overall on infrastructure, reduced storage costs by 52%. And at the same time, the VMs by 21%, VM sizes, I should say, by 21% for most of their applications. At the same time, the thin provisioning and compression that we mentioned before would optimize their environment so that their storage utilization would increase by 50%. And they could reduce their software licensing as well, and that was 15%. A lot of numbers here, but take a quick glance. Oh, and by the way, that 15% doesn't include a 36% overall our infrastructure savings shown as well. Okay, it's time for our last poll question. And once again, we can't ask you, but we'll just give you the results from before. The biggest obstacle in the previous survey participants was one of these three. 13% said their biggest obstacle to migration was performance oriented, that they weren't getting the performance they needed in their cloud. The number one was actually cost, which is why we spent a lot of time talking about the TCO. That 61% of the previous participants said that storage costs were holding them back from migration. Scale in general, they couldn't run large workloads cost efficiently. 8% said that was their number one. And then 18% of the last participants said they didn't have any obstacles. To summarize it all, Lightbits delivers the fastest block storage available on AWS or Azure. End of story. Delivering high throughput and consistent low latency that scales with your application demand. With Lightbits, you'll get more predictable, lower costs. You'd be paying on a consumption basis, not on provisioned IOs and having to do all that guesswork. And you may find that you use fewer EC2 instances or Azure VMs, and that can reduce your database or application licensing costs. You'll get flexibility, being able to scale that performance and the capacity independently, and you'll get this SAN in the cloud kind of advantage by managing your resources as a pool instead of more of a direct attached model, as well as those enterprise data services that we talked about, the provisioning, compression, snapshots, clones, et cetera. And that all comes at no additional cost. Also, Lightbits licenses are portable between, if you have multiple clouds, like public in the public cloud or a private cloud you're building, so you can do a hybrid cloud with and share those licenses for Lightbits. And then finally, to prove the value to prospective customers, we're launching a new offer with a risk-free guarantee. And that risk-free guarantee is that we can provide superior performance at less than half the cost of native storage. And we call it the Cloud Quick Start Kit. It has three steps. First, we schedule a 30-minute call where we discuss your workloads and your overall environment. Then we'll assess whether we think Lightbits can deliver the expected performance and cost savings improvements. And if so, we'll offer you, I make this offer of a quick start kit of $30,000 to $50,000 to get started. And that is refundable. And I'll get to that in a minute. We will test, and if you buy that, we will test and optimize your workloads and deliver a comprehensive report that shows the expected performance and TCO savings. If we demonstrate that we can meet that guarantee, then the full value of the quick start kit can be credited toward your deployment. Otherwise, if we don't, you can request and receive a full refund. So, okay, it is time for questions. We've had a couple come in, like I said, no more since then. So, Sagy, you ready for questions?
Yeah, but okay. Even before that, I just want to say one thing related to the cost reduction success story that Janet was talking about. Mm-hmm. Remember that in the cloud, you're using instances that have predefined storage bandwidth and network bandwidth. With Lightbits, and in most cases, the network bandwidth is always per instance, is always going to be higher. Sometimes it's double than what the local local cloud or cloud provider storage can provide for the instance. So in that success stories and in many actually applications that are you're starting to add more and more clients because you are getting limited at the storage level, always remember that you can actually reduce with Lightbits the number of consumers, the number of clients, and still get more performance than what you got from, you know, EBS, IO2 Block Express, or IO2, or even GP3 limitations, and also on Azure Ultra and Premium SSDs. So everything with Lightbits is over the network. So in case there are cases, and we are seeing this, where actually instead of increasing more and more clients on the other side, let's say more Cassandra clients, you actually reduce them, and each of these clients can consume more using Lightbits. Now I'm ready for the questions.
Okay, well, that was a good question, though. It's a little bit more detail there. Okay, so this one says, will Lightbits work natively with Oracle ASM?
Yes. So the test that we've shown here, these numbers were not with ASM. I have numbers with ASM. I should probably add them to the next webinar. They're actually, the difference is a little bit even better on the Lightbit side. We are, as I said, an NVMe block provider over TCP. And from ASM perspective, or from, you know, the Linux operating system perspective, we're just a local NVMe device. ASM works perfect with the Lightbits.
Okay. So this is, says you showed the performance number for Kubernetes. How is the performance on bare metal different?
So tests that I've done, actually, you know, even to a little bit to my surprise, I've shown that the call it a quote unquote penalty of using Kubernetes and the Kubernetes network stack is not significant. So if you take the test that I've done with MySQL, for example, which was on a bare metal, and you slide that into Kubernetes, you get pretty much the same performance. In fact, you probably have, you don't have maybe better performance, but you probably have a little bit more isolation because you can choose very easily in Kubernetes through cgroup, you know, how to isolate the amount of memory and CPU cycles that your pod is having. So I don't see any performance difference.
Okay. Okay, I think that's all for questions today. I wanted to thank everyone for attending and joining us today for this webinar on performance with Lightbits. Be sure to check out the resources like the white papers that are uploaded within Bright Talk. Share this presentation, this webinar with your colleagues. And if you want a demo, we can be waiting to do one of those TCO analysis and a demo. You can request it on the Lightbits website, or you can use the QR code right there. Thank you, everyone.
And good night. Thank you.